Hello, teachers. We are so excited to bring you a few episodes about the 1918 Spanish flu. And joining me here on this call is Kenneth C. Davis, author of More Deadly Than War, The Hidden History of the Spanish Flu in the First World War. My name is Jessica Ellison. I'm a teacher educator at the Minnesota Historical Society. And we're just going to bring you some brief information and some primary sources about the Spanish flu as it feels really relevant these days. So episode one, More Deadly Than War. And we're going to come back to these primary sources to kind of take a closer look. But first, we're going to go right to my friend Ken. And we're going to ask him a couple questions about the Spanish flu. So good morning, Ken. How are you?
Good morning, Jessica. It is a pleasure to be with you, and it is a pleasure to participate in this experiment in bringing some online learning to our teacher friends. We're all getting used to the new reality of physical distancing and online learning. So what I hope to do is just bring some of my resources and some of my information in a way that can help teachers in their classrooms deal with what is this new reality of teaching about pandemics when we are in the midst of one.
Perfect. So let's start with a basic question then to kind of level us all up. So can you give us just a brief overview of the 1918 Spanish flu pandemic?
Sure. The Spanish flu pandemic is the name that was given to it sort of in the midst of it. It started out being called other things like the Purple Death. Basically, it began in March of 1918 in the United States, primarily on army camps, army bases, and we'll come back to this connection to World War I in a minute. But the flu was unusual in many senses. People knew what the flu was, or influenza, or they called it the grip. It started on army bases where lots of young men were gathered together in very crowded quarters, 50,000 men in barracks, in army camps all over the country, because the United States was ramping up to send troops to Europe, where the First World War was being fought. Of course, they didn't call it that then. It would only later be called that. They called it the Great War at first. So this very kind of mysterious flu starts to move around some of these army bases, and then it goes from the army bases to the troops as they get on trains and then ships and are taken to Europe. And pretty soon, this explodes across the world. What came to be called the Spanish flu killed between 50 and 100 million people around the world in about a year's time. It's an extraordinary number. In the United States, the losses were about 675,000 Americans. Let me give that some perspective. That's about as many US soldiers as died fighting in World War I, World War II, Korea, and Vietnam put together. It's also about the same number of people who have died from HIV and AIDS in 30 years. This was in about 1 year's time in America, which had about a third of the population as it does today. So the Spanish flu, as it came to be called, affected every aspect of life, it affected society, and certainly it affected history. And that's why we have to understand the lessons that we can learn from looking at this world pandemic, the most deadly pandemic since the Black Plague of the Middle Ages.
And those numbers are startling, the number of people that died. I didn't realize that it was so many. So you alluded to this a little bit, but can you elaborate more on the connection between the war and then the spread of influenza?
You cannot discuss the Spanish flu or the great influenza, the influenza pandemic of 1918, without making the connection to World War I. World War I, of course, starts in August of 1914. It's being fought for 3 years before the United States declares war on Germany. April 1917, the United States has almost no army and no navy at the time. So very, very quickly, we went on this preparedness extravaganza. People were drafted, young men were drafted for the first time since the Civil War. Millions of recruits were sought. And as I mentioned earlier, all of a sudden you had camps spreading out around the country in places like Kansas or outside of Boston, outside of major cities, to train and prepare young men for the killing trenches of Europe, the Western Front. As I said, these young men, many of them healthy farm boys when they reported for duty, started to get sick almost right away in March of 1918. Then they got onto troop transports and were taken to the front. And almost immediately after the arrival of nearly 1 million American doughboys in France, you saw this explosion of the flu spreading around Europe. It was very, very devastating. It actually had an impact on the, not the outcome of the war, but the conduct of the war. The British fleet was not able to sail. 200,000 French and British soldiers were sick with the flu and couldn't fight. The Germans had 500,000 men sick and couldn't mount an offensive in the spring of 1918. They were hoping to start an offensive before the United States troops arrived. So this clearly had an impact on how the war was being fought in the spring. And everything about it was related to the war. Troop ships moving, as I mentioned, troops gathered together in close barracks, refugees crowding cities, shortage of medical supplies, a shortage of doctors who had been pulled from life where they were working in hospitals to go work at battlefield infirmaries or field hospitals. So the war and the flu were completely interconnected. And this is one of the things we need to talk about and understand when we think about history. We often talk about the causes of war. We talk about the battles and the generals and the decisions and the compromises that are made. But we often forget about the human side of the story. And the Spanish flu is one of the best cases we can talk about to talk about how bombs and bullets kill many people, but nothing throughout history has been more deadly than war, as I titled the book. And that's why you cannot understand the history of World War I without understanding the flu, and you can't understand the flu story without understanding World War I.
Oh, more to come, Kenneth. This is so exciting. Such great information. And I think the hidden history part of your title is what's really intriguing to me, is that we don't learn as much about the flu. And to be honest, we don't learn as much about World War I in our instruction as we might World War II. So, excellent.
Well, there are really a lot of lessons to be learned from this, and we'll talk about more of this as we go along. But certainly, because it was wartime, propaganda, censorship, outright lying had a lot to do with the spread of the flu and how deadly it became. Misplaced priorities were very important. The war effort took precedence over public health. And finally, ignoring sound science took precedence. And we'll have some very specific examples of that as we go along. So I think that beyond the fact that this is an important story in history, it's an important story for us to understand as we live through this pandemic. And I just want to emphasize one important fact as we go forward, Jessica, which is I'm speaking about this from the perspective of history and society. We do not offer medical advice or consultations here. There are really good sources, which we will provide some of them, for getting the up-to-date medical information and practical advice about preventing the spread of viruses, whether it's the flu or the coronavirus. So I want to just be very clear on that we're talking about history. But medical advice, please go to your local health department or the CDC for that kind of advice.
Yes, absolutely. We are historians and educators and proud of it. So I'm going to go back to the screen so we can take one more look at these primary sources, because, you know, with all this great information that Kenneth shared, I think it's important to be able then to put some of these sources in front of our students and have them talk through and analyze. So here's a couple, and we will link to these in the resources. I think it might be interesting to have students analyze these with a basic observe, think, wonder, see, think, wonder. What kind of symbolism do they see in the propaganda? What do the words mean, the very specific choices of words? And maybe create their own propaganda piece about World War I and the Spanish flu. And then with the other one, with the sign, it's very clear about the danger of the flu and the number of deaths in the Navy Yard, and then has a specific ask, don't spit. So maybe have your students then create their own sign. What would they put on a sign to prevent the flu? So that's episode one, More Deadly Than War. And I would like to share as a final resource for you. This is the bit.ly that will get to the resources that Kenneth and I have been talking about, bit.ly/MMore, D deadly. And if you have any questions, feel free to direct them to me at jessica.ellison@mnhs.org. So thank you very much, Kenneth, and we will see you all for episode two.